I think I'd risk more.
I might not judge people so quickly.
I'm pretty sure my heart would get bigger.
That would change everything.
That would change everything.
That would change everything. Right?
I'd like to think nothing would hold me back.
Nothing would hold me back.
I'd risk my time.
I'd risk my money.
I'd risk my friendships.
My life.
If I stay in the Bethlehem story,
I think I get it.
Think I get it.
I think I get it.
I think I get it.
We celebrate an event
every year,
but struggle to grasp.
To grasp its true meaning.
To worship, I'd just like us to consider that Jesus didn't just come to save the world. He came to save us. He came to change us. And so as we worship in this next song, I'd like us to just consider that it's not all about everybody. It's also all about us and what Jesus means to us.
The gospel changes everything, the turning point in history, and even now it's changing me from who I was. The story of my Savior calls me to the wonder of the cross. The gospel changes everything, and it is changing me. You say I'm my soul by your blood, and I'm undone by your great love. You just as I am to you, my God. Jesus changes everything. There is no greater mystery that God would come to rescue me from who I was. The kindness of my Savior to the wonder of the cross. Jesus changes everything, and he is changing me. You say I'm my soul by your blood, and I'm undone by your great love. Just just as I am to you, my God, to you, my God, just as I am to you, my God.
We have spent the month of December in this series, right, called Family Tree, looking at all the different people, looking at several of the different folks that were in the lineage of Jesus, so that we didn't just discount ourselves, because sometimes we think we come with so much stuff. How could we ever be accepted into the kingdom? But when we look back at the very human line that Jesus came from, there was a whole lot of stuff. And so today, yeah, amen is right. And so, and a lot of transformation, praise the Lord. And so today, just as we kind of bring this series to a close, but more importantly, as we look forward into next year, as we move from the manger into our current reality with Jesus, right, instead of leaving him behind, then I don't have an ornament with a name on it, right, because the family tree up to Jesus, we talked about, but now it's forward, and it's your name, and it's my name, and it's Chris's name, and Shawnee's name, and could it be little baby Zena's name? By the way, y'all, if you haven't had a chance to congratulate the family, Zena was born. She was actually at Christmas Eve service, 4 days old. We had them like restricted in this little roped off area. Nobody get close to the baby, right? But where do we fit on the tree? And what does that look like for us? And just in case we think that we are just meant to be servants, that we're somehow less than, that we're not worthy of God, well, we're not worthy of God, but Jesus made it so that we were worthy. And so I just want to read this passage to you from Romans 8. It says, for those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. We are woven into the family line. We are not left behind. We are not added on. It says we are children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about adoption to sonship. Sonship and daughtership, that's what it means. You see, the Spirit of God brings us not to be just servants of God, but children of God. It says, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. What does it look like to be a co-heir of Christ? Let me ask you, what does it look like to come from your own family line? Like we often don't have trouble shouting those things out. Like, what is the path that some of it you embrace and some of it you try to shun, right? Like, get away from, move past, be transformed by. What does your life look like? What does the human lineage look like? Because I could say, well, I'm from a line of alcoholics. I'm from a line of drug addicts. Well, one or two. I'm from this and I'm from that. Here's what I bring to bear. But I'm also from a line of generosity and a line of, like, that is all our human lineage. But what does our lineage in Jesus look like? What should it look like? Because they talked about it some in that video, like, what would it be like if we really believed that Jesus was the anchor for our life, that we were moving forward in him? And so, you know, I don't have the traditional sermon for you today. I'm actually going to try to sit. We'll see how that goes. Y'all see there's a music stand over there just in case, right? Because we just don't know if that's going to work. But this day after Christmas, I really just want to sit down for us to sit down and have a chat. Because there are things that we need to take off from our flesh, and there are things that in Christ we put on that makes our lives better and more fulfilling, that lets us not leave Jesus in the manger, but carry Jesus in our hearts in such a way that it changes everything. Because didn't we just say the gospel changes everything? So I'm going to be in Colossians chapter 3. I'm actually going to read to you from the Message, but I invite you to open up your devices or open up your Bibles. Online, family that's online, open up your Bibles, open up your devices. We're not going to have the word up on the screen today, but I just want you to listen to some of the things that we need to take off as we're grafted in. There's another passage that says we're grafted into the family of God, which means we talked about a few weeks ago, which means we're not stuck on the branch. We aren't actually an ornament hanging on the tree. That's where the analogy fails. We are grafted in and actually become one with God. We become family. We are together and united. And so in Colossians chapter 3, and again, I'm going to read from the Message. So if you aren't familiar with that translation, it is not a literal word-for-word translation. But before anybody gets too much headache or heartburn, because I don't want you to miss the message caught up in some other things, Eugene Peterson was a linguistic expert. And so what he does is he takes the original Greek and the original Hebrew, and he brings them to bear in a way that's easier for us to understand, but is very, very true to the intent of what is written. It does not add and it does not take away from, even though it sounds very, very contemporary, okay? So, but it's perfect for a family room conversation, amen? All right, so Colossians chapter 3 says, so if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along, eyes to the ground, absorbed in the things right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what's going on around Christ, because that's where the action is. See things from his perspective. How many times have we gotten caught up in the last 2 years, 3 years, in seeing things from a worldly perspective? And how do we begin to remind ourselves, like, you know that little exercise where you take a rubber band and every time you start to stray, you pop the rubber band and it pops on your wrist? I feel like I'd have a welt on my wrist. But how do we begin to train our minds to see things from the Jesus perspective? Not the American perspective, not the Democratic perspective or the Republican perspective, not the I hate church perspective, but I love God perspective. Like all the things that have happened to divide and cause discord, not the fear perspective. Because let's face it, the last 2 years have been scary. The numbers going up now, it's scary. But from a Christ perspective. It goes on to say, your old life is dead, your new life, which is real life, even though invisible to spectators. So your friends, they may not get it. It's with Christ in God. He is your life. When Christ, your real life, remember, it says, shows up again on this earth, you'll show up too, the real you, the glorious you. Meanwhile, be content with obscurity like Christ. Ouch. And that means, and here's where I want to invite us in to listen, because I can't get up here and preach a sermon on what you specifically need to change to get your lineage more in line with Jesus, right? Like everybody's different. But this passage in Colossians is such a great just overview and touches on different things. So I want you to listen in for the struggles that you have, because we all have them. If you think I can read what I'm about to read and not have a couple of those resonate me and with me and the Holy Spirit go, hey, you, are you paying attention? But listen in for what it is, and then we'll make a shift and look to what it can and should and will be in Christ. The passage says, and that means killing off everything connected with that way of death. Sexual promiscuity, impurity, lust. Oh, how about this? Doing whatever you feel like, whenever you feel like it, grabbing whatever attracts your fancy. That's a life shaped by things and feelings instead of by God. It's because of this kind of thing that God is about to explode in anger. Ooh, we don't want to think that God would ever do that. That's got to be really wrong in the translation. Well, the Greek actually says that God's wrath will come, right? But here's what I want us to see It's not because of us that God's wrath will come. It's because of those things, impurity, lust, evil desires. Like, it's God, even in the word, is focused on the actions. Like, his wrath isn't against us. His wrath is against sin, right? And so it says, it wasn't long ago that you were doing all that stuff, not knowing any better. But you now know better. So let's make sure it's all for good. Get rid of it. Let it be gone for good. The bad temper, the irritability, the meanness, the profanity, the dirty talk. Don't lie to one another. Can I ask if we think back over our last year? Because it's that week, right, between Christmas and New Year's, where we all think back, reflect. What did we get right? What did we get wrong? What do we want to change? If we think back over the last year, what does your life look like without bad temper or irritability? What does my life look like if I'm not chasing what I want to chase in the moment, but I'm stepping back to see things from God's perspective? What does our world look like if just the Christians stopped lying to each other? What do our families look like and our friendships and our relationships? What do our hearts look like if we get rid of all those things? What does my heart look like if I get rid of irritability? You guys, like, let's not be all churchy. We're four and a half months into a renovation that we are living in the midst of. What do our hearts look like? What does our home look like if Pastor Rick and I are leading not from a place of irritability, not from a place of frustration? But what do we fill it with, right? Because it's not just about what we get rid of. Actually, more importantly, it's about what Christ brings into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Goes on to say, you're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes you've stripped off and put in the fire. Ill-fitting means, y'all, that doesn't fit you anymore. Stop putting on what feels awkward. Have you ever been in that place where you go to do something and you're like, I used to do this all the time. Didn't bother me at all. Suddenly it feels wrong. Suddenly it's not okay. That's because that's ill-fitting to us now that we're in Christ. It says, every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with his label on it. The old fashions are obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave, free, they mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included. See, Christianity is inclusive, not exclusive. It is an invitation to every person in every nation, in every state of sin. It's an invitation to come out of that old and put on that new. It says, so chosen by God for this new life of love. Dress in the wardrobe God picked out for you. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength. See, we're called to be strong, but in our culture, some of us in our survivor life experiences, strong means big and loud and in your face, and I'm going to do this thing. And scripture says, quiet strength. Strength that stands and lets God fight that battle while we still stand. We can't do nothing, right? Let me get back to the passage. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. Ooh, I got a mug last year with the word discipline across it. Ugh, some days I just, yeah. Anyway, be even-tempered, content with second place, quick to forgive an offense. Let me repeat that one. Quick to forgive an offense. Not quick to explain to somebody why they're wrong and what they need to do about it, but quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you, and regardless of what else you put on, wear love. Church, what if this year all of our actions and emotions were encased in love, like this passage says? What if the consequences for our kids when they misbehave were encased in love? You know, like there's a whole debate, spanking, no spanking. I have had amazing educators who would never spank their own children still say, but if you're going to spank, you have to make sure if that is the discipline that it is wrapped in love, that you never discipline in anger, you discipline in love. That whatever consequence, because let me tell you, some of the words that are said as by us as parents hurt more than a spank on the bottom ever could, scar deeper. What if every consequence for our children's misbehavior was encased in love? What if disagreements with my spouse were encased in love? What if my business decisions were encased in love? What if my friendships, what if your business decisions, your marriage, your friendships, your interactions with your family, what if all of those were encased in love? See, the passage goes on to say, it's meaning love, it is your basic all-purpose garment. Never be without it. As we reflect on this last year, what situations, like really ask yourself, what situations did I walk through without the wardrobe of Christ's love? What moments do I wish I could go back and take back and get a do-over on? Because in the midst of the heat of the moment, it wasn't Christ's love that I walked in, but it was one of the old ill-fitting garments. How did it turn out? What did it look like? And what could it look like if I walked into it differently? Because everybody around me can be clothed in bitterness and anger and immorality. Everybody around me can be clothed in all the ugly things. But if I'm clothed in the love of Christ, not my own, because I don't have the depth of my own love to do it. Because in my world, in my life, you get what you give, right? But Jesus, what if my response came from that love? We're coming to the close of the passage. It says, let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, not out of step with each other. See, this whole passage is not even about how we interact with God. That was in the very beginning. But all the take off and put on is about how we interact with each other, how we, the church, interact with the rest of the church, and how we, the church, interact with the world, how we, the church, interact with our families. Let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. See, if we're going to be grafted into the tree and actually produce the fruit that Christ produces, then we need to be clothed in thankfulness. It says, let the word of Christ, the message, have run of the house. Give it plenty of room in your lives. Church, how much room does the word of God have in my life? How much room does the word of God have in your life? In all the moments, not just the moments when we feel good or we agree with it, but in all the moments. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense and sing your hearts out to God. Let every detail of your lives, your words, your action, whatever, be done in the name of the Master Jesus. Thanking God the Father every step of the way. You guys, I don't want to discourage us in this. You're like, Pastor Jen, I thought you said this was a family room service. It's a little heavy. But see, if we go back up to the very beginning, the passage tells us that our new life, our real life, even though it's invisible to spectators, is with Christ in God. He is our life. God doesn't see us through our own flesh. God sees us through the love and the perfection of Jesus. And it is that strength that Jesus has that equips and empowers us. And it is the grace that says, okay, redhead, when you lose your, you lost your temper again, I know. Come talk to me about it. I'll help you next time. I'll hit the pause button for you next time. That's just me. I don't know what your thing is. I don't know what you're facing from moment to moment. I struggled with unforgiveness for a long time. But God gave me the strength and the power to forgive. And in my failures, he didn't condemn me. He cheered me on, encouraged me, and built me up so that I could do it. And so, as we in this time look to next year, right? I mean, we've had so much. It is okay. It is okay. We have had so much this last 2 years, from pandemics to politics to all the other health crises caused in the midst of the pandemic, to the division, the racism, the struggles, the challenges. What does it look like next year if just a little bit more, just in a few more situations, we're able to remember to keep on that garment of Christ's love? And not in some we got to get it right attitude, but in a humility that says, God, there's no way I can get it right. But in your power, I can get it better. In your strength, no matter what happens, I can feel better. Walk away better. We have another worship song for you. We're going to head into communion in a few minutes, but what I really would just invite us to do as we look towards a new year that's about to begin is reflect on where are the places that you've been wearing those ill-fitting clothes. Because God doesn't want to scold you for that. He doesn't want to scold me for that. He just wants to be a mirror. Okay, let's just keep it real. And I don't know if the guys relate to this so much, but ladies, do you ever just put something on and you think, like you see it on the hanger and it's going to look great, and you put it on and you look in the mirror and you're like, that doesn't work. That doesn't fit right. It is so quiet in here. I cannot be the only woman in this room. And y'all, guys, you do it too. I see you. Chris, that is because you are so secure in who you are in Jesus. You're a saint, and we're not there yet. But what is it? Where is the place that you walk into that it's like that piece of clothing that you really like, but you should have got rid of 10 years ago, and you keep kind of going back to it every now and then, that you need to wear the love of God instead? And I'd just like you to spend some time with God on that. If you don't know what it is, then ask him to show you, because he will. He's faithful. And surrender that old, ill-fitting garment to him in that place, in that struggle, in that challenge, and invite his love in, and whatever replaces the thing, right? Unforgiveness is replaced by forgiveness and grace. Irritability is replaced by grace and mercy and patience. Prepare your hearts, because once we do that, then we're going to invite you to take communion with us. And I'd like us all to be able to not leave the love of Jesus in the manger, but really reflect on it, take it on, put it on, and then celebrate with communion together. So I just invite you, you don't have to stand, you can if you want, you can get on your knees, whatever's comfortable for you, but as our worship team sings this song over you, I just invite you to reflect. And if you want to look through Colossians 3 at the things you do that, just talk to God. All right, church? We good? Member of the body of Christ, which means you've accepted Jesus into your hearts. And that's as simple as ABC. Admit you're a sinner in need of a Savior. Believe that Jesus is the answer, the Son of God who came to save you, and commit your life. Really, this whole message has been about what are we committing to? What are we going to take off? And what are we going to put on? Not because we want to live in some legalism, but because Jesus came to offer this abundant life of freedom. Before we take communion, I read the Romans verse to you at the beginning, but I really want us to understand what Jesus is inviting us into. So I'm going to read it from the message. The resurrection life you receive from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirit and confirms who we really are. We know who He is and who we are, Father and children. And we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance through Christ. Father God, we come before You. We thank You, Jesus, for the example of communion that You gave us. We ask that You would bless these elements, God, and that they would not be just a religious act, but that they would be a covenant that we made with You, our co-heir, that we made with You, our Savior, to celebrate the abundant life of expectant adventure that You came to give us. In Jesus' name, amen. It says, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread. Peel back the top layer, which I just failed to do. Jesus took the bread and He broke it. And when He had given thanks, He said to the disciples, "Take and eat. This is My body." Then He took a cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the blood of My covenant, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." Today we celebrate the life that we have in Jesus. We celebrate the invitation that we have not to walk in our own strength, and not to stay in our own dirty, ill-fitting clothes, but to put on the love of God and to share that love with a world that needs way more than a nativity set around their tree. They need a living God to transform and change them. I've asked John if he would come up and pray for us.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this is the day after Christmas. We have been preparing for this season. We've gone through Advent. We've been joyful. We've been decorating. We've been getting ready for this day. And now for so many, it's a letdown. Remind us that the promise did not end with a baby in a manger. The promise grew up into a man who taught us how to live, who taught us how to love, and who brings us life. As Matthew West sings, he says, "Even though Christmas is over, the light of the world is still here." So let us go starting this new season and see Your light, feel Your light, and follow Your light. In the name of this man who grew up and died for us that we might live in Him, Jesus Christ. Amen.